Now, our next guest, who I hope is going to click his white camera so I can see where he is Travis Robertson. Travis is a business strategist, a peak performance coach, and professional speaker on topics such as personal performance, business growth, and leadership. By the time he was 30, Travis had watched his life crumble around him. After a decade chasing money in an industry he hated, he was diagnosed with two stress-induced autoimmune diseases, nearly lost his marriage, and found himself $850,000 in debt. Physically sick and emotionally exhausted, Travis knew he had to escape this life he had created for himself. Travis now coaches business owners, executives, leaders, and entrepreneurs on how to create lives and businesses that they don't want to escape from. His clients range from entrepreneurs to multimillionaires, but all of them have one thing in common, which is a desire to create a life and a career they're excited to live out. Travis can be found sharing his principles on life on one of the top blogs in the personal development niche at travisrobertson.com. So I'm going to try to get Travis in here. Let's see how it goes. Drop to add. Okay. There he is. I see your face. Can I hear you?
Can you hear me? I don't know. Can you hear you?
I can hear you. Now, here's a big question for you, Travis. I know that you are on Wi-Fi, so
yes,
you have an option here. Do you feel lucky? Do you feel lucky, Travis?
I feel lucky. I can take Oreos, and now I'm hungry, actually, after that last presentation, and my brain hurts.
I know. My brain hurts. I want Oreos. And for some reason, I keep thinking about those glasses with the big nose because of what was going on Twitter. Anyway, yeah. I can stay on like we did earlier and just mute so that you still have me on if you're a little worried. What do you think?
Let's stay on because, look, we're in the 12th hour, and if in the 12th hour I'm the one that drops the connection, I will never hear the end of it from John Morgan or Jason Dykstra or anybody else. So I don't want to be that guy. So I want you to stay on, keep us rolling in case something happens. I think I have a strong connection. I've tested it a bit earlier today, so I think I'm good. And so I'm hoping I just don't want to be that guy. So please stay on.
All right. I'll stay on. I'm going to mute and I'm going to kind of hide behind the flowers over here. So you're on. You go for it.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Susan. It's really an honor to just be a part of this and to break a Guinness Book of World Records. And now I get to cross that off of my bucket list without actually having to hop across the United States on one leg, which I think I was in line to do. Or it was either that or something with hula hoops, but I couldn't figure out what that was going to be. So this makes it a lot easier. So thank you for the invitation. And by the way, if you hear in the background a bunch of kids like screaming and yelling, we have a big family barbecue going on right now. So I apologize in advance if you hear a bunch of kids screaming, but I'm not about to tell 6 or 7 kids to be quiet for an hour in an afternoon. So anyway, so here's what I want to talk to you guys about. Tell you a little bit about my story, and then I want to share with you some principles that I use with some of my coaching clients to teach you how to create a life you don't want to escape from. And part of how this came about is that when I'm about 34, 35, I'm coming up on 35 years old, and when I hit about 30 years old, my life just basically fell apart. And the way that it all happened is we ended up in debt. I had started working in the technology industry when I was fresh out of college. Actually, I dropped out of college to go into the tech industry, and I made a ton of money. I was successful on every front that you could possibly imagine. I got married young, bought a couple homes, just had a very successful life, as most people define success. But the problem was, what I ended up being was I became really successful at being absolutely miserable. And I started realizing that my success came at the expense of everything else, including my health, including my marriage, including my finances, including just about everything that you can possibly imagine. And I did. I developed shingles by the time I was 25 because I was working about 7 days a week, about 90 hours each week. Never took a vacation day off, and it was just physically ungood. It was terrible for me, and I had high cholesterol. My cholesterol was 351. I had high blood pressure, and I was overweight, and I was 25 years old, and on a fast track to an early grave. And when the doctor told me this, it didn't change anything. Nothing changed. I knew what I needed to do, but I didn't actually do it. And so what happened was, by the time I was 30, I developed, I had shingles, and then I developed another autoimmune disease called vasculitis. And so by this point, I'm lying in a chair. Like, I'll save you the mental imagery of me, just how I was lying in that chair. Basically, I was naked. And so there's the mental imagery you were looking for. And so I'm lying in this chair like buck naked because my body's in pain and I'm just been in and out of the ER over and over and over again. I'm giving myself epinephrine and shots and I'm like, something's got to change. If I'm spending the entire existence that I have trying to escape the life that I've created for myself, there's something wrong here. And I have to go about figuring out how to fix this crap. Basically that I did. So, and yeah, John, I'm waiting for your joke too on that one. So as soon as you stop like throwing up in your mouth, you can just go ahead and toss that joke out there. So here's the thing. I spent the next number of years of my life trying to figure out what is it about people who are successful and who love what they do, who work hard and actually have a successful life, but don't feel like they want to spend every waking moment escaping that life. What is it about them? What are the principles that they live by? What are the realities that they live by? And I put together a series of principles, and we're not going to have time to cover them all today. We're just going to go through a few of them. But I want to share those with you because here's just some alarming stats. Over 51% of all marriages in the U.S. will end in a divorce. The average American family is about $14,000 in debt, consumer debt. That doesn't count the house. That doesn't count the car loans. That doesn't count anything. That's just credit card debt. That's up from about $8,000 about 4 years ago. So it's skyrocketing right now. The average American household watches 4 hours of TV every single day, and over 60% of people are dissatisfied with their jobs. That is a crappy way to live. That is a crappy way for us to actually live our lives, and there is a better way, and I want to show you that, and it doesn't involve, by the way, sitting on a beach, drinking Mai Tais, and you know, working for 4 hours each week. Not that I have anything against what Tim Ferriss talks about, but if that's what you want out of life, I'm here to tell you that I know people who have that and who are miserable, who are absolutely miserable. And I know Ferriss and what he talks about is not just working 4 hours a week, but there's this idea that somewhere in life, we can just create this auto business that's going to run on its own. And then all of a sudden it's going to churn out a couple $100,000 for me every year. And I'm not going to have to do anything for it. It's complete bull crap. And if you think that that's going to make you satisfied, you're wasting your time and you're wasting your life. And I'm going to show that to you. So here's what we're going to do. Tip number one or rule number one about how to create a life you don't want to escape from is I want you to focus on creating the future you, not the present what. Focus on creating the future you, not the present what. And here's what I mean by that. Most people spend so much of their time focusing on what am I going to do with my life? What's going to be next? Like, what am I going to do? What does my life mean? What does the, you know, and it's all about the what. And I get so many questions from people. How do I figure out what I want to do in life? How do I figure out what my calling is in life? What my, you know, what I'm supposed to be doing with my life? And the reality is it's the wrong place to start. It's not about what you're becoming or what you're, excuse me, it's not about what you're doing. It's about who you're becoming. Who are you becoming? And the reality is in my own life, I realized that I've been chasing the what for years. I wanted the money. I wanted the houses. I wanted the cars. I wanted the hot wife, which I still have. I have a hot wife. She's super hot. I love her. So baby, if you're watching this somewhere in another room, I love you. You're hot. So here's the thing. I had all of that stuff, but what I didn't have was who I was inside, and who I was inside, I hated. I hated myself. And I don't want you to hate yourself. I want you to love what it is that you do. I want you to come alive with every waking moment. I want you to wake up excited about the day that is ahead of you. Like Lon. I mean, Lon was freaking excited. He was one energy train, and I'm all excited now because Lon was excited. So here's the thing. I love watching people love what they do. And that's what makes me come alive, is seeing other people love what they do and experience that for themselves. And so focus less on what you're going to do, because that's going to change. That may change down the road. You may go through your life and change what you do 3 or 4 times, but who you're becoming can always be changed. And when I realized this, I was focusing so much on the what am I going to do with my life? What's going to become of me? That when I started shifting and I started focusing on who I was becoming, and looking at who I wanted to become and focusing on the future me, and the future me was happy, was satisfied, was fulfilled, had a life he loved, didn't want to escape from, I started realizing that all the things that I've been doing were wrong. And that's a terrible place to be at. But when you realize that, now you can start changing. You can start doing the things that are going to start growing you and moving you into the person that you need to be to do what it is that you find out that you're supposed to be doing in life. Maybe you know, maybe you don't, but that's fine. What you got to be is capable of doing whatever it is that you're called to do, and the current you, probably not capable if you've been living your life chasing something that is a complete myth and a complete fantasy. So you've got to get the future you into the present so that you can start focusing on what it is that you're supposed to do and actually have the capacity to handle it. So the second thing I want you to do is, I made some notes here because I changed the talk at the last second here. So the second thing I want you to do is don't chase pink tutus unless you love to dance. Don't chase pink tutus unless you love to dance. And here's what I mean by that. A couple days ago, I was having a conversation with my brother-in-law who's in town, and they're visiting, and he's got a business that he's doing, and he absolutely loves it, and he was trying to recruit me for his business. And he's phenomenal at it. He's great at it. I have no interest in what it is that he does. But his attempt to recruit me, he asked me this question. He goes, look, if you knew you could make millions of dollars selling pink tutus, would you? And I said, only if I love to dance. Because at the end of the day, there's somebody out there who loves dance, who loves tutus, who loves dressmaking or whatever, I don't even know how to spell tutus. I'm sorry, it's in my notes and I'm like, I don't even know if this is right, how you actually spell this. But the reality is somebody who loves tutus is going to kill me in any business that I get into because I don't love dance and I don't love tutus. So don't chase pink tutus unless you love to dance, because the minute you start trying to do something just for the money, you've lost, because there's somebody out there who's doing it because they love it. And when things get difficult, when the business hits a wall, when you wake up one night or you're working till 3 a.m. to get the business off the ground, the person who actually loves tutus is going to be up there killing it, doing it while you're in your bed going, I freaking hate tutus and I don't even know how to spell it. This isn't the easiest $1 million I've ever made. And the reality is the more you try and chase the pink tutus, the more distracted you're becoming from what it is that you were actually intended to do. So don't chase pink tutus unless you absolutely love to dance. Find what it is that you're passionate about and go do that, because you will kill anybody who's in that business just to make money versus if they're in it because they absolutely love it. So third thing I want you to do is I want you to get intimate with fear. And I was actually going to title this Start Making Out with Fear, but that was kind of a little creepy and that sounded like something John would say, John Morgan would say, is actually get kind of kinky with it. So I was going to call it Making Out with Fear, but we'll just say get intimate with fear. And here's what I want you to realize. Fear is one of the best things that you will ever encounter when you start pursuing what it is that you're supposed to be doing, when you start changing who you are and you stop chasing the pink tutus and you start finding what it is that you're passionate about and you start going after that, what you're going to encounter is fear. And here's why this is a wonderful thing. Because when you're faced with two roads and they diverge and you're like, one of them, I'm not afraid to walk down, and the other one, I am afraid to walk down. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to walk down the road that is the one that scares you the most. In my life, it has served me well to confront my fears and to realize that fear is just a best friend on the road, letting me know that I'm stretching myself, that I'm pushing myself, and that I am getting better at what it is that I want to do. And I'm out there chasing and pursuing what it is that I'm supposed to be doing because I'm afraid. And if I'm not afraid at certain times, I start to wonder, you know what, maybe I'm slacking off. Maybe I'm taking it too easy. I'm letting up on the gas pedal. And I don't want you to let up on that gas pedal. I want you to be afraid at nearly every single step. And I will tell you the God's honest truth. The more you live with fear, the more you start to miss it when it's gone. Because you start to realize that you're slacking. And the minute you realize you're slacking, you go, oh crap, I got to get back on this. I got to start pushing again. Because when the fear's not there, you've let go. You've phoned it in. And I don't want you phoning it in. If what you're doing, if what you're looking at down the road doesn't scare you to death, it's the wrong thing. People always go, how will I know if it's something that I should be doing? Does it scare you? If it scares you, then it's something you probably ought to be doing, unless it's illegal, and then the fear is probably a good thing. But if it's not illegal and you know you're not being called to be a stripper or anything like that, like then it's a good thing and you should go do it. And if there are any strippers on the line, I apologize in advance for just offending you and calling your what you do terrible. So anyway, so here's the thing. I really do want you to focus on getting intimate with fear and realizing that it is going to be a core part of what you do for the rest of your life, as long as you're trying to create a life that you don't want to escape from, a life of significance. And that's the fourth rule here, is that what most people do is they chase comfort. And instead of chasing comfort, here's the rule: pursue significance. Pursue significance, don't chase comfort. Because the more comfortable you try and become, the more stagnant you will become. And there are so many people who are out there looking for the money, for the cars, for the status symbols. And not that those things are bad, by all means, get them if you want them, have them if you got them, enjoy them if you got them. And look, I love those things. There's nothing wrong with those things inherently, but if that is the only thing that's driving you, is having some sort of comfort level with what you do, and you just want to get to the point where you can just sit back and be comfortable in life, you've missed the purpose of life. It's to find something that you can be significant in and to significantly impact the lives of others in a positive way. Whether you're a computer programmer, or you're a coach, or you're a speaker, or you're an author, or you're a marketing expert, what your goal is to find some level of significance by helping people in what it is that you do, and loving what you do, and being the best at it that you can be. That's significance. And when you're doing that, you're not comfortable. You're pushing. You're trying to make your service, your product, your life, your impact bigger and better. And that's what I want you to be doing. Something that I get asked about a lot is, you know, we hear about all these people who right now, it's really popular to talk about lifestyle businesses, and everybody, it's kind of the catchphrase, and people are talking about, you know, I want to have my lifestyle business, and I want this business that gets me set up, that's cranking out money, that's cranking out stuff, and that just allows me to work very little, live on a beach, drink Mai Tais, and you know, spend a lot of time with my family. And I say, you know what, that's a great dream, but the reality is so much different. The reality of life is so much different, that I actually know people who have that capacity, and they're right now sitting there going, this is meaningless. This is absolutely worthless. And the reason is because they're not impacting anybody's lives. It's all about them. It's all about what they thought was the fantasy lifestyle is just something that is empty. And they realized it too late, and now they're stuck with a business that's cranking out a lot of money. Nothing wrong with that, but they're realizing that it's empty. It's devoid of anything, it's void of anything that makes them come alive, that makes them passionate about what it is that they do. And we were created and designed to work, and we were created and designed to love what it is that we do, and for work to be an extension of who we are. It's why when you meet somebody at a party, the first thing you ask them is, what do you do? What do you do? How do you identify yourself? Are you a carpenter? Do you love it? Are you a lawyer? Do you love it? I'm sorry. Are you a speaker? Are you a coach? Are you an author? Are you a marketing expert? Are you a computer programmer? I was a computer programmer, and I freaking hated it. I was good at it, but I wasn't great at it, and I never would be great at it, because I was absolutely miserable at it. I didn't love it. It didn't make me come alive. It wasn't who I was. And too many people are out there finding things that just make them comfortable rather than finding ways to make themselves significant. And the reality is, when we're afraid, we're uncomfortable. That's why I say get used to living with fear. When you get used to living with fear, you start to realize that it's a pretty uncomfortable way to live. But the people who are our heroes, the people who changed the world, were uncomfortable the majority of the time. Steve Jobs once said that if you want to do something great, find something that you love and go do that. And you look at people like Martin Luther King, you look at people like Rosa Parks, you look at people like, you know, some great heroes. And now, of course, I'm blanking, but anybody that you look at that's a hero, like a hero of mine is Richard Branson. The guy's constantly stretching the boundaries of what is possible. And the reason he's doing it is he's keeping things moving forward. He's always uncomfortable. Our heroes in life were not sitting back going, I'm operating from my comfort zone. They were operating from a place of fear, because where there is no fear, there is no courage. And the reality is, we all want to be thought of as courageous people. We all want to be thought of as trailblazers. We all want to be thought of as somebody who made a difference, who made an impact in people's lives. But we don't want to face it with fear. We want to do it from the comfort and the safety of our protective little four-bedroom, three-bath houses in the suburbs. And the reality of life is so much different than that, that if you're wanting to do it, you've got to be willing to risk whatever it is that you've got and go, I'm willing to be uncomfortable. If I have to eat top ramen for a year and do it out of the basement of a house, I'm going to start this computer software company. It's not going to be done on a beach sipping Mai Tais in Thailand. I can create something that's never going to make me come alive, or I can create something that's going to make me come alive. But to do that, it's going to take fear. And in that fear, that's where the courage comes out. If you're not afraid, you're not a courageous person. That's the reality of life. That's why I'm so intent on the fact that you get comfortable with fear and that you get interested in seeing that this is going to be a part of who you are for the next course of your life. That you're going to be uncomfortable, that you're going to be afraid, but you're going to embrace it, and you're going to realize that on the heels of that, that's where significance comes in. That's where you start to make an impact in the lives of others. So the fifth trait, or the fifth rule here that we're talking about, is I want you to train, stop trying. Train, don't try. And so many people, when they start going out and they start pushing to do something big, what they do is they go, okay, I'm going to go on a diet. And I'm going to lose 30 pounds in the next month. Now, granted, they've never dieted before, never exercised, and they join a gym, and they decide that they're going to throw out everything unhealthy, and they're going to just overnight flip the switch. And the reality is, our brains are hardwired to make us fail in that scenario. It very rarely works. And so we try all of these different things, and then we keep failing. And we wonder, why do I keep failing? Why is it that I can't keep this moving forward? And the reason is because we try and tackle too much. And a great example of this is, if you wanted to run a marathon, most people would go, I'm kind of overweight, I haven't run before, and if I want to run a marathon, I'm going to train to run a marathon. Nobody would get up on a Saturday morning and go, hey, there's a marathon down the street, 26.2 miles, I'm kind of heavy set, I just ate a box of Oreos because I just listened to Lon speak and he made me hungry for Oreos. So I just ate a box of Oreos. So I'm hyped up on all the sugar. I'm going to go run a marathon. Nobody would do that. And yet we do it all the time in our careers, in our businesses, in our lives. We start to find things that we just say, I'm going to radically change my life overnight. And the reason we fail is because we don't start training to do that. We don't start preparing ourselves for what it is that we want to become. And so instead of just taking off these massive bites, what we need to do is we need to chunk it down. And we need to start saying, okay, rather than going and joining the gym, how about if for 15 minutes a day I did some push-ups and sit-ups in my house and walked around the block because I've been stagnant? What if instead of saying, you know, I'm going to just quit my job and start a business, you said, instead of doing that, I'm going to start building my business in my spare time and build up to the point where my income almost replaces or maybe does replace my day job, and then I'm going to focus on it full time. What if instead of saying, I'm going to just completely change careers, we started finding ways to work within our career to change it to make it something more fulfilling to us? Sometimes you need a radical change, sometimes you don't. And yes, John, I see John Morgan is a big time runner. Like, he loves running. And if there's anything John Morgan likes, it's working out. And so this is right up his alley. I mean, he's sweating just thinking about it. And you know, he's probably got his bandana out, and you know, he's got his bandana on and his sweatsuit on, getting ready to go run around the block. Because John Morgan loves running, just like me. I freaking hate running. So, which is great that I use a marathon example in my points when I do this one, is like talking about marathons. Like, I've never run a marathon, not even run a 5K. Freaking hate running. So anyway, what you want to do in life is you want to start finding ways, how can I get fractionally or marginally better tomorrow? I don't need to get a lot better tomorrow. I just need to get better than I was today. What are the things that I can do tomorrow, not trying to overhaul everything that I do, but that can start to retrain me and start to get me back on a track that I'm happy with? Maybe it's canceling your subscription to Comcast or DirecTV or whatever you've got and saying, instead of spending that time in front of the TV, I'm going to spend some time improving my skill set, making myself more marketable in the marketplace, and making myself a better asset, or working on who I am on the inside, getting some new skills, getting some new training, working on my habits, because my habits freaking suck. And I need to start changing who I am, doing it small little bits at a time. Don't feel like you have to go from couch to marathon overnight, because it doesn't work in that scenario. It doesn't work in the scenario of life either. It's got to be something that you work on marginally and fractionally and just get 1% better. There's a compound effect that happens in finance. It's the same in our lives, that when we start compounding good decision after good decision, we start realizing that our lives start making a beeline towards what it is that we want out of them, rather than heading in the opposite direction, because it works both ways. It works for us or against us. It's kind of like John Morgan talks about with branding. You have a brand. It's either working for you or against you. It's the same thing with your choices. Your choices and what you're doing in your life, it's either working for you or against you, but it is working. And so that's what you've got to figure out, is if I keep making these choices, where am I going to end up? And how can I start fractionally, marginally improving the choices that I'm making in my daily life so that in the long run, I can be where it is that I really want to be? The sixth trait, or the sixth, I keep calling them traits. Sorry, I'm on another talk in my head because I've got another one coming up. The sixth rule, the sixth principle that I want you to focus on is, I want you to train your gut before you trust your gut. Train your gut before you trust your gut. And this is something that people talk about all the time, is they say, you know what, I've got this gut feeling that this is the right decision. We've all seen these people. They make some of the dumbest decisions of people you ever know, and they keep trusting their gut. And the reason they keep making dumb decisions is because their gut is not trained to make smart decisions. So they go, oh, I've got this gut feeling, like, and you know, it's, you know, acid reflux or something like that. And they have this acid reflux moment, and they go, I have this idea. And I've got this gut feeling that this is going to make me a lot of money. This is going to get me where I want to go. And so they start trusting their gut rather than realizing that, you know what, over the years, you've trained your gut to be an idiot. And your gut right now is a freaking moron, and you should not listen to your gut. Until you start training your gut, stop listening to your gut and start looking for other things that can guide you in the direction that you want to go. Because until you train it, it's just going to steer you in the wrong direction. And I've got a buddy of mine who is a perpetual gambler. And the guy's a moron for doing this. But he goes into Vegas and he just has these gut feelings and starts dropping cash at the roulette table and loses it in a heartbeat. He loses tons of money and we're talking thousands of dollars in a single spin. And he's got the cash to do it, but I still think it's a complete waste of his money. And so he drops all this cash and he goes, I've got a good feeling about this one. Like, really? That's how you're doing this, is just off of that. Your gut is a moron. Stop listening to your gut. If you have a gut instinct about something, but you haven't been training your gut, you do not need to be listening to it. And so that kind of dovetails with the seventh rule for creating a life that you don't want to escape from, is that what you have to do is you do have to get skin in the game. You have to get skin in the game. And one of the there's a couple ways to do this. For me, it was going public with what I wanted to do in life. It was saying, you know what, I'm committed to making a difference in my life. I'm committed to life change, and I'm going to tell my family, I'm going to tell my friends, I'm going to tell people online, I'm going to go public with what it is that I want to do in my life, with what my goals are, what I'm trying to accomplish, and I'm going to make it public so that I can't back out of it. And on top of that, I'm going to invest financially into building this life, into building a life that I don't want to escape from by hiring a coach, by working with people, by seeking outside expertise, by getting people outside of myself. Again, because at the time, my gut was a moron and it was telling me to do things that were completely stupid. And so I needed to check that against the reality of wisdom and against people who had been where I wanted to go, who had done what I wanted to do. And I started studying them. I started looking at what they were doing and I started modeling my life after them. And I started investing in it, not just financially, but emotionally, physically, doing everything in my power to make an absolute difference in my life. I put skin in the game. And too many people, I love the movie The Princess Bride. If you've never seen the movie The Princess Bride, it's one of the greatest movies of all times. And there's this great scene at the end of the movie where the hero of the movie, he's been kind of paralyzed and he's laying in a bed and the villain comes in and points a sword at him and says he's going to kill him. And the hero does this big long talk. And at the end, you know, they start bantering back and forth. And he, you know, one of them says, you know, we are men of actions. Words do not become us. But the reality is the majority of people are men of words or women of words. They love talking about what it is that they're going to do. They love telling you all of their great ideas. They love telling you everything that they're thinking, everything that, you know, all their great ways that they're going to build a business, that they're going to do this, that, or the other thing. But their action is so minuscule. They're so short on action that nothing ever gets done. And we all know those people. They're talkers. They're people who love talking about doing something, who love talking about being significant, who love talking about starting a business, who love talking about changing careers, but they never do anything. And the reason is because they don't actually get skin in the game. They're afraid, they're comfortable, they would rather have their lives of predictable misery than uncomfortable fulfillment. And that is a sad, sad way to live. To live going, I'm predictably miserable. I hate my freaking job. And every day I get up, I used to say this, every day I go to this job, it feels like I'm driving another nail into my coffin. That is a piss poor way to live your life. And I know so many people who say that about their jobs and they go, you know what, one day when I retire, then I'm going to do something that I really want to do. No, you're not. If you can't do it now, you're not going to do it when you retire. The reality is, this is your chance. You may not even make it to retirement. That's the God's honest truth. You may not even make it to retirement. So you've got to start finding ways to say, you know what, I'm going to go for, instead of predictable misery, for uncomfortable fulfillment and uncomfortable significance. And I'm going to start putting skin in the game and I'm going to start getting out there and taking action. Because when I take action, I'm putting everything behind. It's not just intention. The best of it, you know, the road to hell is paved with great intentions. It's not just intentions. You've got to have the action on the backside of that that's backing into it and saying, everything that I've got is going into what it is that I've been talking about for however long you've been talking about it. That's what makes for us putting skin in the game. And if you feel like you need help doing that, if you feel like that's something you need to do, you can talk to me. You can talk to some of the other coaches who've been on there. You can go to travisrobertsoncoaching.com. You can sign up for a free session. We can talk about it, see if coaching's right for you. But if it's not, it's not. But the reality is you've got to be out there putting skin in the game, getting behind it, finding people who know what you're doing and who have been where it is that you want to go and can offer you sound advice. Because again, if you're trusting your gut without training your gut, you're trusting a moron, and you don't want to trust a moron. You want to trust somebody who knows what's going on and who's trained to help and who's trained to see things for what they are. And you've got to find those outside influences, those outside people. So just to recap, the seven steps or the seven rules here and the seven principles that we've been talking about on how to create a life you don't want to escape from. And then we're going to dive in. I've tried to leave as much time as possible for Q&A here at the end. So let me just kind of recap the seven guiding rules here that we've talked about. The first one is I want you to focus on creating the future you and not focusing on the present what. Don't focus on what you're doing. Focus on who you're becoming. Because in that, as you focus on who you're becoming, you'll figure out what it is that you're supposed to be doing. But it's not going to come necessarily before. You've got to be prepared. You've got to be the you that's going to be able to handle the what that you're supposed to be doing. So instead of worrying about what am I supposed to do, start worrying about who you're becoming. The second thing I want you to do is I don't want you to chase pink tutus unless you love to dance. Just because you can make $1 million selling pink tutus, if you don't love dance, if you don't love tutus, don't start a business selling pink tutus, because you're going to get killed by somebody who loves pink tutus and loves to dance. Find something that you love to do and go do that and kill it at that and kill the competition that's doing it just for the money. The third thing I want you to do is I want you to get intimate with fear. I want you to start realizing that fear is a signpost. It's something in your life that can guide you in the direction that you should be going. You have two paths. Choose the path that scares you, not the path that you go, that looks pretty easy. That looks comfortable. That looks like I'm not afraid of doing that. If you're not afraid of doing it, it's the wrong thing for you. I want you to find that fear. I want you to embrace that fear. I want you to get intimate with that fear, recognize it and go, awesome. I'm afraid of that path. That's the path I'm supposed to be on. That's the path I'm supposed to be going down. Fourth rule, I want you to pursue significance, not comfort. Pursue significance, not comfort. Because the reality is when you're fulfilled in your life, when you're doing something that impacts the lives of others, that makes you come alive, that makes you significant in what it is that you do, not famous, by the way. Don't misunderstand this as being famous, but being significant in what it is that you do. Because if you go sell pink tutus and you love dance and you love selling pink tutus, chances are good you're not going to be famous. But if you're fulfilled and you're fulfilling the dreams of little girls to dance around in pink tutus and you are the best freaking pink tutu maker in the world, and this is probably the Guinness World Record for how many times pink tutu has ever been said in a presentation. So if you love that and this is something that makes you come alive, you're going to have a fulfilled, fascinating, wonderful life. And a life of significance. And you're going to fulfill the dreams of little girls across the country and some little boys too who want to dance in a pink tutu. And that's what I want you to do. I want you to pursue significance, not comfort. Because if all you're doing is looking for ways to stay comfortable, you're missing so much that life has to offer. And I know because I did it. I wanted the things. I wanted the status symbols. I wanted everything that would say this is a comfortable life. And all it got me was a couple autoimmune diseases and a broken marriage and a buttload of debt that I had to climb out under. So don't do this. And you know, we're well on the other side of that now, and it's wonderful and it's awesome. And life is so much better on this side. I work my butt off and I love every minute of it. I'm not sitting on a beach drinking Mai Tais. I'm finding something that makes me come alive, and I'm pouring every ounce of who I am into it. And I want the same thing for you. Fifth thing, train, don't try. Train, don't try. Don't try things. Trying means failing. I want you to train to do whatever it is that you want to do. Start looking at your career, at your life, at your business the same way an athlete looks at their life, career, or business. They train every day of their lives for what the best ones do. The worst ones don't, but the best ones train every day of their life. They know that if they slip off just one day, if they take just one day off, if they just loosen up one bit, they lose their edge and they start going down a path that they have a hard time correcting from. So I want you to start looking at your life and going, where can I be training and not trying? Where have I been sitting back going, well, I keep trying to start that business. I keep trying to change careers. I keep trying to do this. And all of a sudden you go, you know what? Screw trying. I'm going to start training to do it, and I am going to do it. You know, screw this whole trying crap. I'm going to find a way to make a difference in my life by training for what it is that I want. When you start doing that, your life is going to take a whole new turn, and you're going to have things that you never believed you were possible. Doors of opportunity are going to open for you in amazing ways, in absolutely amazing ways, because you're now ready for those opportunities. It's amazing how many opportunities open up when you're looking for them and when you're ready for them. Exactly. Yoda. Thank you, Robert. Do or do not. There is no try. And there's a great example of this. Tony Robbins, a hero of mine, did a phenomenal example in one of his seminars. He told a lady who kept saying, I'm trying to have a better marriage. I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to do that. He told her, he's like, turn around and try to pick up your chair. And she picked up the chair, and he goes, no, I didn't say pick up the chair. I said, try to pick up the chair. And she picked up the chair again, and he goes, no, you're not hearing me. I want you to try to pick up the chair. And it went on like this over and over and over again. And she finally got frustrated. And the reality was, he goes, look, you can't try to do anything. You either do it or you don't do it. And that's how it is in life. You're either training to do it or you're just trying to do it, which means I'm half-assing it. And let's just be honest. If you're running around going, well, I'm trying to start a business. I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to do that. All that means is I've been half-assing it and I'm too afraid to admit it to myself. So here's a better thing. Admit it to yourself and go, you know what, I've been kind of half-assing this. And so instead of just trying to do it, I'm going to start training to do it. And I'm going to start finding ways to do what the people who have been where I want to be have done. So if I want to start a company that's similar to an Apple and I want to go, I want to model my career after Apple, the last thing I'm going to do is not look at Steve Jobs and not figure out what he's done. I'm going to study everything that he did. I'm going to start modeling my life after him and going, okay, I got to hustle. I got to bust my ass to get this thing out there. That's what you've got to do, is find what it is that you're supposed to do and start training to do it. Sixth thing, train your gut before you trust your gut. And I'm just going to say this one more time. Don't trust your gut if you haven't been training, because your gut is an idiot unless you've been training your gut to be smart. And because look, we all need our gut instincts. We all need that first reaction. And that first reaction sometimes has to be right on. But the more you train your gut, the more you can trust your gut. And too many people, I've seen this over and over and over again, especially in people that I've worked with, that I've coached. They've come to me and they've said, I've wound up in this place and it seemed like the right thing to do at the time. I had a gut instinct about it. I had a gut feeling about it. And I went with my gut and it got me in a world of hurt. And the reason is because they hadn't trained their gut to respond in the right way. So you've got to start training, reading, studying the master, studying the people who are where you want to be. That's all about training your gut. I hate TV. I hate, unless it's football season, then I love TV. But I hate TV. And the reason I hate TV is because it fills my mind, it fills my gut with just the most useless crap. Instead, I spend all of my time, my free time, studying, learning, reading, figuring out what it is that, how can I make myself better? I never want to stop learning. The minute I stop learning, my gut's going to become an idiot again. And I don't want an idiot for a gut. I want to know what it is that I'm supposed to be doing. And the seventh thing is, you've got to put skin in the game. That means back it up with action. Tell people what it is that you're going to do. Invest financially, emotionally, physically, spiritually, energy-wise into it. Put everything you've got behind what it is that you say that you want to do. And I guarantee you, you are going to find a way to make it happen. But if you don't invest in it, if you don't put skin in the game, if you don't find somebody who can help you, who can mentor you, who can teach you, who can, you know, get you over that hurdle, you are going to end up just limping along. And I don't want you to limp along. So that's the seven steps. I think we've got about 20 minutes right now for some Q&A. So hopefully, start firing your questions away. And Susan, if you're around, I'll let you come back in. I don't know if you've got some questions and have seen stuff been flowing in, because I've been ignoring the chat strictly because John Morgan was in here and also Jason Dykstra was in here, and I knew I was going to get heckled. And so... There you are.
They were surprisingly nice to you. They weren't nearly as mean as they were to Mitch, I have to be honest. But then you weren't here being mean either. So, you were just here being awesome.
Yeah.
And by the way,
Barney, thank you so much for that. I really appreciate that.
The things on Twitter, there was a whole tweet thing going on. You're getting tweeted a lot. Let's get some questions. Here we go. Here's one. How can I better train my gut? How do I know when it's trustable? That's a great question.
Great question. And here's the thing, is that one thing that I had to do is I started realizing that, I hope I'm still live here. My computer just, for whatever reason, put the screen. All right, am I here?
Yep, we can still see you and hear you.
I apologize for that. My screensaver came on for whatever reason, and I have no idea why. I thought I shut that off, so I apologize. So here's what happened. The thing that I realized, and I was actually having a conversation with a neighbor of mine the other day. We had him over for a barbecue and we were talking about this, and I was just telling him about the books I was reading. I was like, oh man, I'm reading this book, I'm reading that book. And I said, are you reading any good books? And he goes, actually, I'm not reading anything. I said, why aren't you reading anything? And he goes, I just don't have the time. And I said, bull crap, you don't have the time. You're not making the time. And what I started to realize is that in my own life, where I started to be able to trust my gut is when what my gut instinct was lined up with the people that I trusted to give me advice. So I found early on in my career, or as I was changing directions in my career and I was becoming a coach and I was going after things and doing things different, and I left the tech world and said, I'm done with tech, I'm done being a programmer, I'm done being a CTO, I'm done running that side of businesses, and I'm switching to a consulting coaching role. What I did is I went to people who had been where I was and I got advice from them. And I just started learning everything that I could from them. I pestered them with questions. I read a ton of books. I mean, I have literally probably hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands of books that I've read over the last few years just to learn. And all of a sudden, what I started to realize is that my gut instincts started lining up with the people that I trusted to give me the advice that I was seeking. And when that happened, that was a trigger for me. And I started realizing, holy crap, I can trust my own instincts. Now my instincts are good and my instincts are getting better. And every day I'm trying to do something to make my instincts better so that when the crunch time comes, I don't have to sit and wait around for somebody else to give me advice. I know instantly, am I on the right path or am I not on the right path? And I'm okay. I'm not afraid to fail. That's another thing, by the way. Don't be afraid to fail. Too many people are worried that, oh, what if I fail at this? What if you fail at it? Nobody's going to care. We live in a 24-hour news cycle. You can fail on live camera in front of hundreds of thousands of people on national news and people will forget about it in an hour because something else is going on. Don't worry if you fail. Failing is just experimenting. You know, it's just finding ways that it didn't work. It's like Thomas Edison said, I didn't fail to create a light bulb 20,000 times. I just found 20,000 ways to not create a light bulb. And our mindset needs to be the same thing in business and in life, is just to go, I'm going to freaking try it. And if I don't succeed at it, I'm going to figure out why. I'm either going to come back at it at a different direction, or I'm going to go, yeah, it wasn't really me. And I failed at it because my heart wasn't in it. And I'm going to go find something that my heart was in. I'm going to succeed at that. And I'm just going to look at life as an experiment. You get one shot at this, make the most of it, have some fun with it, try, you know, and maybe I shouldn't say try because I told people not to try, but experiment with it, you know, train to do stuff and then go do it and see what happens and see if you succeed. So great question. What are there? I can't even watch all these things fly by here. Was there something else?
There's a good one. John Morgan is asking a constructive question.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Are you there? Did I lose you? Susan?
Did you lose me? They lost me? Yeah. Are you there? Are. Can you hear me?
I'm still live. Woo! Saved. Saved.
Okay. Saved. Yes. Nice. It's always better when
they're... it's going to suck if we lose you and I have to stay connected for the next like 3 hours until you get back up. So, you know, if that happens. I want credit on this world record. I want to be like sponsored by Susan and Travis.
No, well, you don't know. I don't know if you guys just heard the police outside. Apparently they found me, but they just went by. Okay. What you guys don't know is that for a lot of this evening, Ben Cope, the internet genius, who is hosting in like an hour and 15 minutes, he's taking over hosting duties for a while. He's been on this whole time, like as my backup. So it's been fantastic. I mean, I haven't really had to worry if my T1 line went down, but I don't think it is. Anyway, John had a great question. Now it's off this screen, so let me try to scroll down and get it. Because, you know, if John's going to ask a good question, we should make sure we answer it. Okay, so it says, I often tell people not to model someone's product or service, but to model their behavior. Can you talk about the process of how to do that?
Yeah, and, you know, this is and I'm just going to use I'm not going to use that example because I was going to use an example from a client, but I don't have permission and I don't think the person would mind, but just to be on the safe side, I'm not going to do that. So here's the thing is that John is absolutely right, is that too many people try and do copycat products or copycat services and they go, oh, well, so-and-so does this. And John talked about this earlier in his presentation. So if you didn't see it, go back and watch it because it was phenomenal and it's loaded with information. And what they basically do is they go, well, they offer this in red. I'm going to offer it in blue and charge a dollar less. And it's this copycat mentality of saying, rather than coming up with my own creative spin on it and my own creative ideas, I'm going to go out and do what other people are doing exactly like they're doing it. And the reality is the world doesn't need another Coca-Cola. You know, just because I go, I have a great idea for a soda, doesn't mean I'm going to go out and do exactly what Coca-Cola did and just create a competitor to Coca-Cola. Instead, what I'm going to find out is I'm going to find out the behaviors that they, and John is right, it's behavior, it's not specifics, in the sense that I'm not going to go try and create another Apple computers. But if I wanted to create a company on the level of success of Apple, what I might do is study Steve Jobs and go, what was his management style? What was his personality style? What was his work ethic like? What did he do? And I do, and I'll give an example of this. Richard Branson owns 330 companies or whatever it is now, and he's probably started another three just while I've been talking. And the reason he does this is he's a master delegator. The guy barely finished, I don't even think he finished high school. I can't remember now. I'm confusing all my people and dropouts. But basically dyslexic like crazy. Had to learn early on, how do I delegate what it is that I can't do in life? Because there, in order to be successful, I'm not going to be able to wait until I can figure out what all these things say. So he became really, really good at delegating early on. So what I do is I look at that and go, okay, I suck at delegating. I can be honest about that. I'm a terrible delegator. I'm a control freak. And so what I have to do is I have to start finding ways, how can I model that behavior? I'm not going to go start 330 companies, but what I am going to do is I'm going to find things that he does well and go, okay, in my business, in my career, in what it is that I do, where are the areas that I'm not delegating the ways that I should? Where are the areas that I'm taking on too much control, that I'm trying to micromanage the process rather than freeing other people up to do what it is that they do best? And so I'm finding ways to model my behavior after them. And then what I do is I work backwards. I go, so in order to delegate, what is it that I need to do differently? And I write down what it is that I need to do differently. And I start putting a plan in place to implement it slowly. It's not an overnight thing. It's not like all of a sudden tomorrow I wake up and go, okay, everybody, here's your new assignments. It's what I do is I find ways to slowly offload it onto the people that get them trained, get them set up, get them ready to go so that I can delegate more of what it is that I want to do. And I'm modeling the behavior of delegation, not the action of going, I'm going to create the next Virgin Atlantic and I'm going to have a record label and then I'm going to have a, you know, an airline and I'm going to do space travel and then I'm going to, you know, have a nonprofit. You know, I'm not doing that. The world doesn't need another Virgin. What it needs is another, it needs me to be fully myself, not somebody else, but to learn from what they did to become successful so that I can apply that into my business. I think it was Jay-Z who said, there's 1,000 yous and there's only one of me. And the reality is there's 1,000 us's, there's only one of you. There's only one person like you who can do what it is that you're supposed to do in the way that you're supposed to do it. Go do that, but learn from people who came before you and find out how to streamline the process. You don't have to do it all, like reinvent the wheel every single time. You can find ways to learn from people and build up your skill set and model their behavior, not their businesses. Please don't model their businesses. You're just going to become another Me Too product or service. And we don't need another Me Too product or service. We need you to be fully you doing what it is that you fully love and are fully invested in. So John, did that answer your question? John's probably typing. Anything else while we're doing this?
He said yes. Good. There was another one. Let's see if we find it. Okay. Reversing the failure concept. How can the fear of success become an attribute?
Oh, I gotcha. Okay. I'm sorry. Ooh, boy, great question. The same basic principles apply, is that whatever your, because, and I know people, I actually work with people who have that fear of success, like, oh crap, what if it works? And there's this fear of like, oh, you know, I'm launching this new product, I'm launching this new thing or service, what if all of a sudden it takes off and I can't handle the business, or I can't handle what it is that I'm supposed to do? And what if I'm actually good at it and I have to quit my job, or I have to change careers, or I have to do that fear? You know, I think we, fear of failure and fear of success, honestly, they're the exact same side of they're different sides of the same coin. And whatever it is that you're afraid of is what you need to move toward. And that's how I use it in my life. I look at it and go, if I'm afraid of succeeding in this area, I have to figure out why I'm afraid of succeeding. I have to figure out what it is that freaks me out about succeeding. Is it that I'm actually going to be, you know, and actually I'm going to give a personal example of this. When I first started my speaking career, it was a few years back, and I had never been on a big stage before. I had done some small little stages before, and somebody saw me and they're like, we've got to get you on this big stage. And it was like the difference between speaking to 50 people in a room and the difference and going overnight to speak to a room full of, there were like 450 people in the room. To go from 50 to 450, I had like no training for this, and I was completely afraid of getting that opportunity. And I had to apply for it, but I had a friend who could fast track me and basically guarantee that I was going to get on that stage. And I was actually going to have a keynote session, and I was going to be the closing keynote, and he said, all you have to do is submit the application. I postponed submitting that application for weeks, and the event organizer finally called me, and he's like, if you don't submit the application, we're like you're never welcome back to our event ever. Like, we're not going to invite you back, because we specifically have been holding this spot for you on a recommendation of somebody else. And I was so afraid that they were actually going to put me on the stage that I didn't want to do it. And I realized that fear of success, fear of failure, what it meant is that I was going to be successful getting on the stage, and then I was going to fail at actually doing well. And that's what most people do, is they go, well, I'm afraid of success. No, you're afraid of succeeding and then not keeping that success. You're afraid of getting to a level and then, what if I can't maintain that pace? What if I can't keep that going? It's all the same thing. And if that's what you're afraid of, go do it and step out of your comfort zone. Because if you're in your comfort zone, that's a, again, it's a crappy place to stay, is in your comfort zone, because all it means is you're wasting away slowly, but you're comfortable and you think that you're good. And you're not comfortable. You're dying slowly, and you're going to wake up 20 years from now and realize that I wasted 20 years of my life, and I don't want you to do that. So if fear of success, fear of failure, it's really the same thing. It just means you're afraid of getting it and then losing it. And what happens if you get there and people think you're a fraud or a phony, or what if they call you out or they catch you, like this whole identity thing? You know, a lot of people go, oh, you know what? It's this fear of being found out. And we all have this fear of like, I'm going to be found out to be an imposter. And, you know, you're not. If you're honest, it doesn't mean, you know, look, we're all really talking to a room full of marketers half the time. And we all market ourselves. We all find ways of, you know, angling what it is that we do for the audience that we're talking to. That's not lying. That's not cheating. It's not playing this game. It's letting people know that I have a technology background. I've run companies. I've started companies. I've built businesses. I've, you know, been founders of multiple companies, And I've also had my share of failures. Now, depending on who I'm talking to, I may leave the failures out depending on what the talk is, what it is that I'm doing, or I may bring the failures in. And it's just finding out, how do I angle what it is that I do in a way that I can communicate to the people that I want to communicate to? It's not about being found out. And unless you're a complete fraud, nobody's going to find you out. And all these fears, it's just you trying to prevent yourself from actually doing what it is that you're supposed to be doing. And that's why if I'm afraid of doing something, that's the thing I go do. So it really is the same thing. So let's see, Mike says, saying you're going to do something is much easier than actually doing it. What's the biggest tip you can give to someone to actually take action? Oh, great question. Here's the thing, Mike, chunk it down. There's a difference between where you want to get and what you have to do to get there. And I think what happens is we oftentimes get overwhelmed with, you know, all the steps that have to be taken between where we are and where we want to be. And so we start to freak out. We start to go, the distance between where I am and where I want to be freaks me out, and I don't know where to start. The first thing you can do is go, look, if I can only do one thing today to move me closer to my goal, what is that one thing? Just one thing. Like, you don't need to climb Mount Everest. You don't need to do anything that's going to just be near impossible for you to do. All you have to do is find one thing that will move you closer to your goal today and do it. And don't go to sleep. Don't go to bed. Don't turn on the TV, don't listen to the radio, don't do anything until you get that one thing done. Just do one thing and do it well, and then get the next thing on your list the next day. Like, you don't have to have the entire roadmap figured out, because business plans, these things freaking waste your time. And here's what I'm going to say. If you're waiting to start a business until you have a business plan, stop. because you will never know everything that you need to do before you launch your business. The reality is that business plan is going to be completely useless in about 2 weeks after you launch your business, because you're going to realize that it was all conjecture. It was all hypotheticals done in a vacuum. Get out into the real world and start doing it, whatever it is, whether that's losing weight, whether that's starting a business, whether that's, you know, changing careers, and just find one thing you can do right now today to move yourself forward and do it. Just do it. Don't make excuses. Just do it. And then do it again tomorrow and do it again tomorrow and find some way of keeping yourself accountable to that methodology, keeping yourself accountable to keeping things moving forward. I created an accountability group. A group of guys that we were all starting our businesses, and we just all got together and would every week go, did you do what you were supposed to do? Commit to it. And if you didn't, we were hard on each other if we slacked off. Anything you can do to keep yourself accountable. That's why I paid a coach. It's why I paid money on different things, because the minute I put my money there, I wanted to make sure that I didn't waste my money. I put skin in the game, and that's start getting skin in the game. Start taking action. Start doing one thing at a time and moving yourself closer. Yeah, boy, Robert, that's so true. Physically unhealthy people are comfortable and they die sooner. Dude, I was so comfortable. I was fat and I had high cholesterol and I had, you know, 2 autoimmune diseases and, you know, high blood pressure. I was super comfortable and I was on a fast road to the grave. So thank you, Mike. I appreciate that. So yeah, Jason, yeah, I lived in the South. That is why they call it comfort food. So real quick, I think we got a couple more minutes. Any other quick questions? Thank you, Denise. I appreciate that. Any other quick questions? So no, Susan, I think I'm done here. And you are awesome for inviting me. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thanks for coming, and thanks for coming when you had family in town.
Oh, you know what? They're upstairs, and they're giving me a hard time, and so I get some surf and turf when I get up there. My brother-in-law is a phenomenal cook, and so he's up there making some surf and turf, so I get to go eat and have a glass of wine and sit out on the deck, so I'm really looking forward to it. Jason, how'd I get so good looking? That's a phenomenally uncomfortable question to answer.
That's a great question. But also, could you do me a favor and just send John Morgan like a tweet or an email? Tell him what internet company you are. I think he could use a recommendation.
Well, I'm like, John, here's the thing. I pay a lot of money for my internet connection so that I can do video and do different things. And John Morgan just happens to be a cheap, cheap person. Like, he's probably on dial-up. Like, he's probably on that net zero or whatever it was. You know, he's got AOL dial-up. He still gets the CDs in the mail, and he's like, sweet, 54 more free hours. I'm going to go to a chat room after this. Harass people on dial-up. Bing, bong, bing, bong. So,
yeah. My internet connection involves hamster and duct tape.
I'm sure it does. Here's the thing. It's like, how do I fix this? So, hopefully it's better. And I'll see you tomorrow, Susan. I guess I'm on the call with you guys doing live Q&A tomorrow. Right?
Yeah, it's going to be great. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Sounds good. Now, you know, you're going to be on Wi-Fi. Robert says he's got his problem fixed, but who knows? So it should be really interesting.
It's going to be fun. And I think we're talking about how to build a speaking business. I think that's what we're doing. Is that what we're doing?
That's what I heard. Who knows what it could turn into by tomorrow? Who knows what it could turn into while we're doing it?
It's true.
You just don't know.
It's true. We'll go wherever the audience takes us. So this is fun. Thank you again, Susan. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys. No. You guys are awesome.
Absolutely. And
go kill it. And don't settle. Create a life you don't want to escape from, please. Talk to you guys later.